interview with Ron Sabota after spending a week with him and, like an idiot, not videoing any of it. And some of the things we talked about was the thing that fascinated me and stood with me is after we came out of the cages, you and I had this conversation about hitting. And I asked you, you know, given the technology today, what you think you'd be as a hitter, being able to break down a pitcher's motion and such. And you said, and I'm going to ask you the question again. Well, I really want to get it on tape. This is unbelievable.
My reaction would be that sometimes you get too much information. You can have too much of a concept of what's going to happen instead of being more in a reactive mode. I think more of what I think you would learn is about yourself and the correct technique of hitting. And the guy that I played with and knew more about that than anybody else was Cleon Jones. And we've talked in the years after I've retired, and I still do some AAA baseball broadcasting in New Orleans. But learning how to get yourself ready to prepare your position, your hands ready, your feet ready, your balance ready to react at that point of decision. Get to that best, most efficient point of decision. And you're going to look for pitches at times. You're going to look for certain pitches. You might look for certain locations. You know, it's a little different thing. It depends on who the guy is out there and what you're doing. But you try not to overburden the decision-making process with too much information.
Now, I actually got to watch you. You were in one of the cages, still doing T-work. And you know,
we didn't even do that when I was there.
There was no T-work back then. So no. Basically, what would you guys do as far as getting?
We had a hitting cage, and you know, somebody needed to throw to you, and or you'd use one of those machines that threw straight fastballs like that. And we didn't like them too much, but nowadays they do soft toss and T-work, and I think you can sometimes isolate a swing better with T-work. You know, just really think about the mechanics of where your hands are when the ball is here, where your hands are in your body position when the ball is here, and then work on that, and you can get as much done with that. I think sometimes guys today take too much medication. We never heard of a broken hammy.
Yeah, you were talking about that.
You have
too,
to, the yeah, you have to take too many swings with a knob in the palm of your hand, probably. Guys pulling intercostal muscles, you know, little muscles in their swing because their weight room work has tuned them up too much. So I think there's a lot of differences. And the trade-offs are some of these little nitsy injuries that guys have that we never have.
I also noticed while you were in working on the T-work, you were really working on the rotation of your hips also. Is that something that was big in your swing? Like, if when you go back and look at films,
I don't know if
playing,
you can, you know, it's the whole thing is a dynamic, and the analogy that I would make more to the way you swing a bat is the way you throw a ball. You look at the bottom half of somebody when they throw the ball. Say a third baseman or a shortstop throwing to second base. You watch his bottom half when he throws the ball. It looks pretty much like a swing, or it should. Your swing should be timed like that. And the same thing is when you throw the ball, you prepare your hands, or you prepare your bat, and you stride. And when you stride, you just kind of reach. You don't put any weight on it, you reach. You put your foot where you want to hit to. And then let your weight follow your hand as you follow through, if you decide to. But the attitude should be, I'm swinging at it, unless my eyes tell me no. That's the way
I'm glad we finally got to get this on tape, because
I guess that's a theory, I don't know. You know, when you hit 241, sometimes they go, what the hell did you know?
And then one other thing, which I was able to write about, but I'd rather hear it from you. You told me three great Tug Rule stories, but if you could just tell me one.
Now, Tug was a beautiful guy, and somebody asked him one time, what did you prefer to play on, natural grass or astroturf? And he said, I don't know, I never smoked any astroturf. You're telling the truth.
And then lastly,
I thought I made that up, but Tug said he did.
Lastly, yeah. An interview with Ron Sabota would not be complete if you walked us through the greatest catch in World Series history.
I don't know if it's that, but it was a pretty good play. I know one thing. There's a guy on the Texas Rangers, Nelson Cruz, he made about one half of that catch, you know what I'm saying? And they'd be wearing World Series baseball. But, yeah, you know, you're lucky, you know, you're lucky when you make a play that is the absolute end of the extension of you in a full layout on your backhand side, you're running as hard as you can to get to a ball that's looking like it's going to beat you.
Excellent. Thanks so much. It's a pleasure spending the week with you.
It was good, wasn't it? It was good.
Unbelievable.
It was.
Thanks, Roger.